Well, church, we're carrying on the series from the book of Acts. Right, as you know, today we are focusing, okay, on Acts chapters 18 and 19. And chapters 18 and 19, okay, is one whereby we look at the whole area of no neutral zone. No neutral zone. How many of us, sometimes in differences, disagreements, maybe in conflicts, we prefer to remain neutral? Can I see your hands? We prefer not to take sides, prefer to remain neutral, because neutral is very safe. Can I see your hands? Wow, all the safe people. How many of us, you cannot wait to take sides? You really want to take sides, right? Because you're not tahan that guy. Can I see your hands? Anyone here? Oh, God, a few also. God bless you as well. Okay? But friends, you know, in life, okay, in life and living, right, sorry, I forgot. Let me just introduce a friend of ours who's worshiping here, Reverend Roger, okay, Kolmeyer from Sri Lanka. I forgot to mention, sorry, allow me to just intro, I forgot about it. Okay, great to have you here, Reverend Roger, okay, joining us. He pastors the Colombo Gospel Tabernacle, a great church. I was there speaking at a church camp, and what a fantastic church, and your leadership there, Pastor Roger. Thank you for coming and joining us this morning, okay, in a dream center where all your dreams have come alive. Well, many times, friends, you know, in life, sometimes we are pushed into a corner where we have to take sides. We have no choice because we cannot remain neutral. It is nice. It is comfortable. All right. It is easy not to take sides at all, isn't it? Because that will produce a less amount of injury. That will produce a less amount of misunderstanding. It is better to remain neutral. It is better, friends, to be on the safe side, as it were. But friends, life and reality is one whereby there are times we cannot take sides. There are times we cannot remain neutral. There are times we will pitch for one or the other and will not be easy, friends. But that's a challenge for all of us. And that's exactly, friends, you know what you and I see now in this book of Acts here, in Acts 18 and 19, about the life and ministry of Apostle Paul in this regard here. That Apostle Paul is telling us through the writings of Dr. Luke, there is firstly no neutrality regarding the gospel. That in the gospel of Jesus Christ, you and I cannot remain neutral whatsoever. And that's how, friends, you know, Dr. Duke records for us like this in Acts 18, verses 5 to 11, where Apostle Paul has gone right to Corinth, okay, in his missionary journey, waiting for his two other colleagues to come to join him. And whilst waiting there in Corinth, he cannot wait to want to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And now that's a record for us now, Acts 18, verses 5 to 11. Let's read together, church. Together, let's read with all our robust voices. Together, church. When Silas and Timothy came from Macedonia, Paul devoted himself exclusively to preaching, to testifying to the Jews that Jesus was a Christ. But when the Jews opposed Paul and became abusive, he shook out his clothes in protest and said to them, "Your blood be on your own heads. I'm clear of my responsibility. From now on, I will go to the Gentiles." Then Paul left the synagogue and went next door to the house of Titius Justus, a worshiper of God. Crispus, the synagogue ruler, and his entire household believed in the Lord. And many of the Corinthians who heard him believed and were baptized. One night, the Lord spoke to Paul in a vision. "Do not be afraid. Keep on speaking. Do not be silent, for I'm with you. No one is going to attack and harm you, because I have many people in this city." So Paul stayed for a year and a half, teaching them the word of God. Teaching them the word of God. You see, friends, here is a perfect example of Apostle Paul being asked that he cannot take sides with regards to the gospel. Right? He has to take sides with regards to the gospel. He cannot remain neutral. And that's a reminder to all of us, isn't it? That there must be that bonus in sharing our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so Acts again, 18 verses 9 and 10, let me read what it says to us. One night the Lord spoke to Paul in a vision. "Do not be afraid. Keep on speaking. Do not be silent. For I am with you and no one is going to attack and harm you because I have many people in the city." You see, friends, we find that God has to break through as well in the life of the Apostle Paul to tell him, to remind him, carry on preaching. My son, carry on and be unafraid about it. Carry on, because why? I've got people in the city who will stand with you in the difficult task that you are involved in doing. Now, how many of us, sometimes in sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, we are reserved, sometimes we're even a little bit fearful. How many of us are like that? See your hands. Okay, honest confession in UMC, especially we have added marks for you in heaven. No, not true. Okay, can I say, how many of us, we are reserved, we are hesitant, we are sometimes even fearful to share, to talk about Jesus with our friends, you know? Because sometimes, especially nowadays, when we all want to be politically correct, They tell you, your friends maybe tell you, don't talk about religion, don't talk about politics, the same. Why? Because that's most divisive of all topics like this. So let's be neutral. Let's be nice towards one another. But friends, you know, sometimes it's not possible. I will show you why it is not possible. It is critical for you and I, as the example of Apostle Paul, as urged by God, speaking to Apostle Paul in the vision. Don't be afraid. Carry on speaking. Now, sometimes we're filled with fear. We have reservations, and rightly so. And church, can I say, learn from the example of Apostle Paul. In what way you and I can learn from the example of Apostle Paul? Ephesians chapter 6, okay, verses 9, right? Verses 9, 19, and 20. Church, let's read together again, aloud, together. Pray also for me, that whenever I open my mouth, words may be given me, so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I'm ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare fearlessly, as I should. So even this great apostle, he asks for prayer. Pray for me, so that I declare the word of God fearlessly, as I should, as we must. Friends, and it's so important, isn't it? So for those of us who just put up our hands to say that you sometimes you're hesitant, you're reserved, maybe you're even fearful to talk and share about Jesus, can I urge you, encourage you, challenge you, pray first. Ask God to help you. Ask God to enable you to overcome your fear, your reservation, whatsoever else. Why? Because the good news of Jesus Christ is the greatest and the most important news in the whole world. And all do you agree, say? Isn't it? It's the most important news in the whole world. It's the news that people need. It's the news that everybody needs, isn't it? And that's important. It's the news that, for example, ISIS people need. Hello? They need to know there's a God who loves them. They need to know they don't have to train themselves in the direction of recklessness, violence, and evil. Because violence don't win at the end. Can you get amen for that? It never wins, isn't it? And so, friends, at times we are fearful. Pray, like an apostle Paul. Ask people to pray with you. And that's so very important for all of us, isn't it? Right? Because this is the greatest of all news. So we must share and make it known to as many people as possible. As Apostle Paul was urged, even by the vision from God, to go on speaking, not to be afraid whatsoever. All right? Because my hand will be upon you. Now, I just come back from Singapore day before yesterday. Because I was invited by the richest man in Singapore to speak to his senior staff and the top management. And so when Doris and I arrived at the airport, Changi Airport, there's a driver there fetching us, okay, from the airport to the hotel, okay? And all right, it was not just an ordinary placard, okay? They have upgraded, especially in Singapore, iPad waiting for you, Mr. and Mrs. Daniel Ho. Wow, I still got style in Singapore, you know what I mean? So what happened, this driver, picked us up from the airport, took us, okay, to the car. It was a limousine. It was a Bentley. Wow, my goodness. I looked at the car, I almost fainted, okay. We got into the car and took us, okay, all right, to the hotel. And his name has been given to me earlier and his phone number. I say, hi, Max, I really want to thank you for fetching us, okay, from the airport to the hotel. Really, really appreciate that, okay? Max, I'm Daniel Ho, I'm a pastor. He said, what, you are a pastor? This is shocking, surprising. I thought you're a big-time businessman. Yeah, from Malaysia, yes. I lead a big operation in Malaysia whereby I've got enterprise, okay? The company I work for has got business in every country in the whole world. Amen, isn't it? Okay, and our business deals with the womb to the tomb. Every kind of work we deal with. Isn't it? All kinds of business we deal with. That's the kind of company. I just so happened to head up one of the bigger, okay, branches in Malaysia. Okay, and the amazing thing is I got 4,000 old people who come every week. You know, not only I don't have to pay them, every weekend they come and pay me. And so what happens is, I said to him, Max, so are you a Christian? He says, yes. I was so happy. Why? Because I said, Max, if you're not a Christian, I'm going to share with you all the way from the airport to the hotel and challenge you at the end, okay, to accept Jesus, because it is no accident. God has designed you to pick me and my wife only and nobody else on that day. Well, say amen to encourage me. Yeah, so I shared with him, okay? All right. And he says, he's a Christian. I said, that's great, that's wonderful. Max, you know, when you become a Christian? He says, 17, 18 years ago. What church you go to? He says, I go to City Harvest Church. City Harvest Church. I said, that's a great church. Okay, City Harvest Church. Okay, all right. This is a wonderful church. I said, you know what? I've been praying for your pastor, Kong Hee. Huh, you know my pastor. So his driving became better. Okay, in the process. Do you know what I told him? In future, if you pick up passengers, whoever, okay, as you get into a lovely, wonderful limousine, say to the guy that you picked up, especially maybe as a total stranger, say to the guy, sir, if you don't mind, I've got something that has happened to me amazingly in my life. It is so good that, you know, is it okay if I share with you? Can I hear amen for that? It is so good, sir. Something that's happened to me in my life. Is it okay I share with you? All right? I believe that guy cannot wait to want to listen. What is a good thing that he has got, okay, that he wants to tell me? And friends, you know, as you and I know, the best thing to have happened to us is to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Can I get an amen for that? Isn't it? It has brought amazing freedom and joy and so forth. And so you just ask. I told Max, from now onwards, every passenger that you pick up and send it to the airport, wherever else, to the office, that kind of thing, you just say, okay, sir, it's so good. Welcome to Singapore. Okay, but sir, you know what? I've got something so good that has happened to me in my life. Is it okay if I share with you? And see what the response is, isn't it? Normally, most people would like to listen to some good things that have happened to someone else's life. Get a good amen for that, isn't it? Who doesn't want to listen about good things that has happened? See how his response is. And his response is, yes, yes, please tell me about it. You just go ahead and share what Jesus has done for you in your life, isn't it? Because he cannot refute you, he cannot challenge you, he cannot, okay, argue with you, because it is real for you in your life. Can I get a good amen for that? Hello, are you still there? It's so important, isn't it, for you and I to be not neutral about the gospel of Jesus Christ. As you notice, friends, Apostle Paul has to take a stand as well when he was there in Corinth. Be unafraid to preach, be unafraid to make it known in a wonderful manner. And it's so critical for all of us, isn't it? You can also use the other way. Let me suggest another way. Another way is, you know, sometimes, especially when you build friendships and relationships with someone that you know, over time, you build friendships and relationships, you tell the guy, or you tell the lady, all right, okay? You tell the person, you know what? I got a friend of mine. This friend is amazing. He's such a good friend. He will never leave me. He will never forsake me. He is even better than my wife. And don't say that part in front of your wife, okay? Right, you might be misunderstood. Like this pastor who got recently married to his wife, and both of them are sitting in a swing, okay, and enjoying themselves and so on and so forth, and were sitting in a swing enjoying each other. Suddenly, out of the blue, the brand new husband said to the wife, by the way, you know, I want to let you know I've got another lover. Wow, the wife was going to punch him, okay? What is this rubbish you're talking about? Finally, when this man said, you know, my other lover is actually the Lord Jesus Christ. Okay, fine, fine, fine. Come, let's pray. We need to pray for each other, that kind of thing like this. So share with your friend. I've got a best friend that no one can beat. This friend will never leave me nor forsake me. This friend will never fail me. This friend will never betray me. Sometimes I'll be betrayed by some of my friends, but this guy will never play me out. You would like to know, can I introduce this friend of mine to you? And share Jesus with them. Can you get amen for that? Is that okay? Think of ways and means, creative ways and means to share, to talk about Jesus. Be unafraid. Friends, can I say, the more you talk about it, the easier it becomes. Can you get amen for that? Life is like this. The more you do it, the more you practice, the easier it becomes. Like, I've just come back from actually Hanoi as well, speaking at the Hanoi International Church, okay, in Vietnam, at the 20th anniversary celebration there. And we're put in a nice, lovely hotel, okay, in Hanoi City, owned by a Singaporean, a Christian, actually, okay, and so they hosted us so nicely, everything is free of charge and that kind of thing there. And then on the Sunday afternoon, I've got a guest who's coming to take both Doris and I. I said, we'd like to have a look at Hanoi City because we have never been to Vietnam before. And they were shocked. You mean, you have never been? God have mercy upon you. You don't know how much you miss in life, never come to Vietnam. I said, okay, fine, take us to Hanoi City, look around, that kind of thing. And then I told the receptionist before our guest came, I said, you know, I'm expecting guests to come, okay, to take us out to Hanoi City to look around. And, okay, my guest is so-and-so, and that's our room number, okay? After I say that, by the way, my name is Daniel Ho. I'm a pastor from Malaysia. okay, God has sent me here today to talk to you. You are very special, okay? I said, what's your name? The tech, they said, Sophia, T-H-U-I. I said, that's a great name, Sophia. You know the meaning of the name Sophia? She says, yes, I know, okay? Because she said, I Google, that's great. And it means wise, smart, clever. No wonder God sent me to a smart, clever people only. No, not true. Share with about Jesus. I said, my pastor, are you a Christian, Sophia? She says, I'm not. But you know, when I was young, I always loved to go to church. I enjoy getting close to people who go to church because something good things that I see happening. But ever since then, I've lost touch, lost contact whatsoever. So I said, Sophia, this is very special today. Can I lead you to trust in Christ? She said, I will try. You don't have to try. You just trust. She said, okay, just say yes, I will lead you. And I said to her, because she's actually working at the receptionist counter, I want to be fair to her, to the management also. Okay, I said, Sophia, only 2 minutes. So in 2 minutes, let me explain how to trust in Jesus and lead you to Christ. And she followed me in that. And then, you know, I asked the receptionist working with her, the next one, also a fellow Vietnamese, what's your name? Anna. Okay, are you a Christian, Anna? She says, I am. I said, that's great, fantastic. You know, Anna, make sure, okay, you follow. All right, Sophia, I'll take her to your church and everything. Is it okay? I led Sophia to Christ for friends that afternoon. That was my number 44 this year. Church, can I challenge you all, really? All right, can I challenge you? Every one of us must lead one to Christ a year. Because think about it again, you know my challenge. If every one of us were to lead one to Christ in 1 year, just 1 year, lead one to Christ, DMC will double every year. Can I get amen for that? And likewise, that's my challenge to church after church around the world, that everyone lead one to Christ. I challenge likewise the Yoido Full Gospel Church, the largest in the world of 800,000. I challenge a senior pastor, a friend of mine. Challenge your people, everyone in your church, to lead one to Christ. You know what happens with 800,000 people? Next year, your church will be 1.6 million. Following year, it'll be 3.2 million and goes on and on. All right, you will touch the whole world for Jesus Christ in no time like this. So I want to challenge you, friends. But you see, friends, it is not just leading people to Christ. That's it. My burden is all follow up for these people. I want to ensure that these people are properly follow up. And so therefore, I will take down the details, refer them, if I lead them overseas to a church, to someone I know of, or contact, whatever, so that these people can pick up and follow up these people. Because why? You and I must do responsible evangelism. Can I get amen for that, isn't it? So reach out to people around. And so I was burdened about follow-up, so I told Anna, make sure she's followed up. But I was also thinking, how can I get hold of a Vietnamese Bible for her? Although she could speak both English and Vietnamese well, of course. And then in our hotel room, lo and behold, I discovered the Gideon Bibles in our hotel room. I was so happy. And the Gideon Bible, friends, is in Vietnamese and English. Oh, I was right doubly happy in that regard. So you know, church, I quietly take the Bible from hotel room, put nice envelope, and present to her. I believe the hotel management don't mind now. Because the owner is Christian, he must thank me for the rest of his life for giving him. Now, Christian staff will become a better staff. Am I right or not? Okay, by the way, I've written to the senior pastor of Hanoi International Church, okay, to say to him, okay, would you inform, okay, the owner of the hotel to say that I have taken, right, the Vietnamese Bible from my hotel room 528 where we stayed, okay, can you please replace it? But I suggest one other thing for the senior pastor to tell the owner of the hotel. I said, you know what, don't put Vietnamese Bibles in hotel rooms. Because most people who stay in your hotel, they will normally be English speaking. Hello? How many Vietnamese will come and stay in your fancy hotel, isn't it? All right? So therefore, I can give away that Vietnamese Bible guilt-free. That's it. All right, now, I'm making good use of the Bible, okay, in his hotel for someone who understands Vietnamese and therefore English as well like this. So I wrote a note to say, okay, Pastor Jacob, could you make sure tell the hotel owner, put English Bibles in there, okay, isn't it? Because we also met Japanese, okay, guests staying in our hotel as well as a witness to everybody around, and that's important, isn't it? Church, the idea is this. You and I must find every opportunity for contact to share the good news of Christ. You and I cannot remain neutral, my friends. Really, really. As we see in this passage of Scripture, there's no neutrality about the gospel. This news is so good, so amazing, so powerful. Friends, you and I must share. Can you good amen for that? Make it known. Make it a prayer. but also follow through as much as possible to make sure that these people will be properly discipled in a process like this. So every person I lead to Christ, I will write down the date I led them to Christ, where I led them to Christ, their name, and also follow up as well as much as I can. And friends, you know what? I pray for these people regularly over the years. Really. They are all in my diary. Okay, and one of them whom I led to faith in Christ here, coming from overseas, he's today on staff with us. I said, when you receive Christ, he remembers a year. I said, I can tell you exact date. Okay, all right. I led you to Christ here in this place after the Saturday celebration. He was shocked. I said, yeah, your name is my diary. I carry your name all over the world. Okay, wow, like that. Must be very special anointing that I've got now, okay? So pray for these people, very important, isn't it? Because we want to make sure that they come to faith in Christ, they're followed up well, they grow mature in Christ, and challenge them now to reach out to other people with the Lord Jesus Christ, with the faith of the gospel. Can I get a good amen for that, isn't it? So church, you and I, you notice in this passage of scripture, cannot be neutral about the gospel. But also secondly, friends, there is no neutrality, you and I must see, about the spirit world as well. No neutrality about the spirit world. And this is what we read of in Acts 19, verses 11 to 20. All right, in Apostle Paul's ministry, there is amazing power encounter that took place, okay? And this is a record for us, Acts 19, 11 to 20. Church, again, let's read aloud together in our robust voices together, church. God did extraordinary miracles to Paul, so that even handkerchiefs and aprons that had touched him were taken to the sick. And the illnesses were cured, and the evil spirits left them. Some Jews who went around driving out evil spirits tried to invoke the name of the Lord Jesus over those who were demon-possessed. They would say, in the name of Jesus whom Paul preaches, I command you to come out. Seven sons of Sceva, a Jewish chief priest, were doing this. One day the evil spirit answered them, Jesus I know, and I know about Paul. But who are you? Then a man who had the evil spirit jumped on them and overpowered them all. He gave them such a beating that they ran out of the house naked and bleeding. When this became known to the Jews and Greeks living in Ephesus, they were all seized with fear, and the name of the Lord Jesus was held in high honor. Many of those who believed now came and openly confessed their evil deeds. A number who had practiced sorcery brought their scrolls together and burned them publicly. When they calculated the value of the scrolls, the total came to 50,000 drachmas. And this word, the word of the Lord spread widely and grew in power. By the way, the 50,000 drachmas, the value of the scrolls that was burned, one drachma is equivalent to the wage of one person working a day. So therefore, 50,000 drachmas is equivalent to 50,000 people working in one day. That's a lot of money, isn't it? And they're willing, right, to surrender all that is wrong and evil today. By the way, over the years, I've gone to homes of people to pray for house cleansing and blessing. And some of the objects they've got in the house is just incredible. Some of the things and they've collected, okay, over the years, some of the antique pieces and all kinds of things collected over the years, which is really not helpful at all. In fact, okay, it is harmful for us as Christians. So some of these, I've removed them. You know what? Some of these have come up to hundreds of thousands of dollars. You know, I say, remove, very painful. One of them, I have to saw the big, huge, order, all right, okay, a statue they bought from China, okay, in his pre-believing days as a Christian. Huge statue. I said, Pastor, solid wood brought from China. You know, this is so good. Pastor, you have to remove this. Yeah, not just remove this. You're going to break it apart. Break it apart, Pastor. Can I sell this or not? Okay. I say, please don't. Okay. Can I sell it and give the money to the church? Please don't do that. Please don't do that. So, Chris, sometimes we come to faith in Christ. We think of all creative manner and means, okay, to try to still collect some money and give it to the church. Like this guy said, Pastor, you know, this gold, can I melt it down, sell it, and then give it to the church? I say, please don't do that. Okay. Please don't do that. And so, you know what? I say, you got a saw or something. Okay, and he brought his saw along from his backyard. And as I was going to saw, he walked away to the back because he cannot tahan seeing me saw this thing. Okay, it was painful to his heart. So anyway, I saw it. But it's a piece of solid wood from China, you know, and I paid a lot of money for it. I said, fine, okay, got to get rid of it. Let me saw it. Okay, you saw it. Okay, you know, went to the back, so I saw it. You know, halfway through, really, really heavy and solid. Halfway through, you know what? I hit cement inside. Cement is inside. No wonder it's so heavy. So I call him out. I say, come on, you've been fooled. Okay, it's not solid wood, it's cement inside. Come on, you've been cheated. Chinese people can think of ways and means to make money. Amen. Isn't it? Just crazy, amazing. So he said, you come and see. He saw he was so upset and angry. I said, you are, you know. So he was so happy that it was finally get rid of. I said, you know what? After I saw forever and I saw into the cement, my hands are aching like crazy, you know. My friend, you know what? You better invest into an electric chainsaw for all of us poor pastors. You know? That is so like crazy. Until I came back, my hand is aching like crazy, all right? And some of you, can I say, got things like this in your home. You know that? Someone has got one ton of Buddha statue in his garden. You know, that requires a lorry to carry away. All right? And you know what? There's one home in Damansara Heights. I got rid of all the antique pieces, lots of it. Okay? Next day, the lorry driver came to cut it away. Okay? And the lorry driver said, you know, to the house owner, why don't you don't knock it? Call me. I'll come and pick it out free of charge. Boy, because he thinks he can sell it. Amen, isn't it? But friends, you and I must walk clean, walk clear, new neutrality about the spirit world. No neutrality whatsoever. Why is it so important for all of us? That as Christians, we walk without fear whatsoever. Really, we are unafraid. Not only we are unafraid, we got power and authority to deal with all kinds of spirits. There is an evil spiritual realm as much as there is God's spiritual realm. And friends, you know, you and I, as God's people in God's spiritual realm, has no fear whatsoever to deal with all kinds of evil spiritual realm. And that's a reality for you and I to recognize that. Okay, why is this a case? Mark chapter 3, verses 14 and 15. This is a record for us like this. That Jesus, when he called 12 disciples to himself, before he set them out, okay, all right, to do work and ministry. This is a record given to us by Mark. Let's read together, church. He appointed 12, designating them apostles, that they might be with him and that he might send them out to preach and to have authority to drive out demons. And to have authority to drive out demons is what it is. It is Jesus who has given us this authority and power. Can good amen for that? It is not us. It is not my power, my authority. It is the power and authority that Jesus has given to all of us, isn't it? Likewise, in 1 John chapter 4, verse 4, let's read together, friends. You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. The one who is in you, meaning what? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit who is in you is greater than the one, is greater than Satan and every other evil spirit in the world. And that's the reason why, friends, you know, Christians can walk and move around with no fear whatsoever. You know that? People cannot put charms on us. People cannot put curses on us. Because why? There is a Spirit of God in us. We are covered by the blood of Jesus. Of course, provided, friends, provided we walk right with Jesus. Can I have a good amen for that? Because if we compromise, do wrong things that are wrong, begin to sin against God, we're opening our life to spiritual attacks, you see. But friends, when we walk right with God, no fear whatsoever. And in fact, we walk in victory, we walk in authority. That's the way, friends, all right, you and I walk in. So that we are not, friends, you know, enslaved by superstitious beliefs. All kinds of superstitious beliefs that people are enslaved by. And it's so sad and tragic. They're not living in freedom whatsoever, isn't it? Whereas you and I walk in freedom, in peace, in joy, without fear whatsoever like this, isn't it? It is like the superstitious belief, like, for example, the T-junction of a road. Nobody wants to buy a house or have a house at a T-junction of a road. Am I right? Hello? Are you still there? Because the belief is bad luck, isn't it? But you know what the Malays believe? Malays like to have houses at a T-junction because they believe all the good luck will come from this road into the house. Now, you tell me who is right, who is wrong, isn't it? Okay, there is this guy went to his house many, many years ago to try to clean up the house, pray for blessing upon the house. And what happens is that he's got a mirror stuck in front of his entrance to the house. You know why people put a mirror sometimes for Chinese people? It is to reflect away bad luck, you know? And he was advised, even to a Christian, but a Moon Cha Cha Christian, because before he came to UMC, okay, not quite, okay, clear yet about things of the spirit like that, okay. And so the feng shui master, the Joe Menzies came and said, you know what? Just across the house, look at the house, look at the gate, look at the thing across the house. It looks like a tombstone, and because it looks like a tombstone, you must put a mirror to reflect away all the bad luck. And so when I went there, I said, hey, my friend, why do you put that? So he explained this reason. I said, okay, remove it away. Hey, Pastor, I cannot. Okay. And then before I went to remove it, he says, Pastor, behind is a yellow piece of paper. I said, you want to remove also another yellow piece? Hey, cannot. I moved all kinds of rubbish from his house and finally, you know, brought it outside there by the roadside to burn it. I said, my friend, you light the fire, you set it. Okay, you burned it like, because it is, hey, Pastor, cannot. I said, it's your stuff. You know, what to do? Pastors do all kinds of stuff, okay, for all kinds of crazy people and all good people around, okay? Clean up, pray for it, cleanse it, okay? So that today he walked in peace, freedom, and joy. Today he served us faithfully here in the life of the church. But friends, you know, you and as Christians has amazing power, authority, and victory. We walk in freedom and fear, all right? So anywhere, we walk really with peace, with assurance. It is like this friend of mine who has been invited to speak at a church camp in Kuching, in Sarawak. And what happens was, it was only at the end of the camp he was put to stay in a nice, lovely bungalow, okay, nearby. See, it is the end of the camp, all right? They say to him, okay, sir, how is your stay in the bungalow? He says, great, fantastic. You slept, well, you're fantastic, wonderful, you know. But you know what? That bungalow is well known in Kuching City to be a haunted house. My goodness, church, you will put people, speakers in haunted houses some more. Crazy, sir. All right, you know why? All right, like this. You know, but friends, you know, he slept right through. No problems whatsoever. If he'd been told earlier, not sure, okay, but he'd been told no problems, go in there, do spiritual warfare, command every evil spirit to go in Jesus and cleanse the house and pray for the place like this. And that's what I always do, friends, whenever you check into a hotel room. When you check in a hotel room, pray first, all right? Pray first. Pray for cleansing of the room. And then put your hands and lay your hands, which I normally always do, okay, upon the bed, upon the pillows, upon every nook and corner of the room. Because, friends, you never know who was staying there before. Amen. All kinds of people have stayed there before. All kinds of, sometimes crazy people stayed there before. And they don't know what they do even on bed. Sometimes some of them have even died in hotel rooms. Have I put fear into you, all of you now? It's true, isn't it? All right, but all these things are shut up. They don't want to let you know about it. They keep quiet about it. So all kinds of activities happen. Hotel rooms has happened on bed as well. But as Christians, we have no fear, isn't it? We have no fear. I know the air stewardesses in the past told me, you know, from UMC, whenever they travel, okay, in the flights, that kind of some rooms, some hotels, some parts of the world, they're all afraid. They all bandit together because they know they see evil spirits in the other room. So all the ladies hang out together like this, so fearful because they say, because how do you like, you sleep in a room, okay, in the middle of the night, the dog, how do you like that? Okay, and there's this man, for example, his actual case, was upstairs sleeping, you know, downstairs the television came on. How many would like to have a room like that, a house like that? Yeah, my friends, you know, no problem. We go and pray, cleanse it. We did one house cleansing. One brother, as he was walking down the staircase from upstairs downstairs, God gave him a vision. He saw someone hanging from the ceiling. It's a vision. He told the owner, this is what I saw in a vision. I think there is death in this house. There is suicide in this house. And then you know what she said? She said, no wonder. Sometimes when I'm taking care of my baby upstairs, I hear noises downstairs. Very strange. In fact, I've got a dog who one day got terrified by noises. My dog rushed out of the house. And I have not got a dog back ever since. Even dogs are scared. Isn't it? And if you hear dogs howling in the middle of the night, then you know what happens. Yeah, really. Like this guy went to his house, as I told, removed the mirror and everything else. He called me because he said, Pastor, my two Alsatian dogs have been howling every night for several days. Every night for several days. I said, sometimes dogs are smarter, more sensitive than human beings like you. No, I didn't say that. Yeah, I said, no problem. Let's go and deal with it. Cleanse it. Why? Because sometimes, friends, can I say, dog picks up certain things. You notice sometimes you take a dog to a jungle walk, the dog suddenly stops and begins to growl. You notice that? Because the dog picks up something. You know, it's quite amazing, friends, when you deal with spiritual warfare and stuff like this. And just can I say, I hope I've not put fear in any one of you. Hello? No? Okay. How many brave Ghostbusters here? Can I see your hands? Hey, all the Ghostbusters, can I see your hands? My goodness, so few. You're in trouble, my friends. You know? Can I say, here in DMC, we got a wonderful training entitled Spiritual Warfare. Yeah. If you've not gone to it, can I ask you all, everyone must go through it. Because it's a casting of evil spirits, dealing with powers of evil and darkness. It's not just for some specialists, just for some spiritual people. Not true, friends. Any Christian can do that. Because of the power authority in you that Jesus gives you. Not yourself, it's from Jesus. And only Jesus. Friends, you know, when you drive out evil spirits, all kinds of spirits, even the high-level spirits, you begin to see how powerful the name of Jesus is. Really, I guarantee you that. But don't go in blindly. Don't go in not prepared. Don't go in when there's sins in your life, and they're compromising, because if you go in, you're open for spiritual attacks. But when we confess our sins, put ourselves right, and seek to always walk right, we have no fear. We're going to deal with it. And so, church, can I urge you and ask you to do that? Sign up for spiritual warfare training. Okay, it's one of the many trainings. Can I urge you to sign up for all the trainings in DMC? Because why? We're here to equip every single one to become a Ghostbuster. Can I go amen for that? Say to your neighbor, you're a Ghostbuster, or you're supposed to be one. So you will say to your neighbor, we're here to help and train to be strong in the Lord Jesus Christ, to be fearless for God, not in an arrogant manner, not in a proud manner, but in a humble manner. Isn't it? But in a fearless about it. Why? Because when we're confronted, we dare to deal with it. In fact, next Sunday, listen to the testimony of this sister, all right, who is going to get baptized. Why? Because she shares how she was attacked by evil spirits. And even just as a new person in Christ, calling upon the name of Jesus, evil spirits would flee. That's amazing power, friends, you know. Therefore, as Christians, no fear. That's why we live in freedom. Therefore, every single number is a good number. Number 4, number 13, they're all good numbers. Can good amen for that? Okay, so T-junction houses, buy it now, because it's always cheaper. Am I right? Why not? It's a good deal, you know. Or houses whereby your compound is, right, is triangular, it's angle in shape. Chinese believe that's bad. Hey, buy it lah. Okay, that's why one of the elders bought it, very clever, bought it at a good price like this, when nobody else wanted, isn't it? So church, you know, in a spirit world, there is no neutrality. And we are unafraid to take a stand. Because you and I have got authority and power in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the reason why you notice Luke 10, 17, where the 72 were sent up by Jesus. And when they came back, this is a record, the Dr. Luke records for us like this, Luke 10, 17. The 72 returned with joy and said, Lord, even the demons submit to us in your name. It is in the name of Jesus, not in our name, not in any other name, but in the name of Jesus. Can you get amen for that? You see? So friends, you know, there is no neutrality regarding, all right, the gospel. There is no neutrality regarding, friends, the whole area of spirit war. Third and finally, there is no neutrality regarding idolatry. Regarding idolatry. And so this is a record for us in Acts 19, verses 23 to 31. Church, let's read together. About that time, there arose a great disturbance about the way. A silversmith named Demetrius, who made silver shrines of Artemis, brought in no little business for the craftsmen. He called them together, along with the workmen in related trades, and said, "Men, you know we receive a good income from this business. And you see and hear how this fellow Paul has convinced and led astray large numbers of people here in Ephesus and in practically the whole province of Asia. He says that man-made gods are no gods at all. There is danger not only that our trade will lose its good name, but also that the temple of the great goddess Artemis will be discredited, and the goddess herself, who is worshipped throughout the whole province of Asia and the world, will be robbed of her divine majesty." When they heard this, they were furious and began shouting, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians!" Soon the whole city was in an uproar. The people seized Gaius and Aristarchus, Paul's traveling companions from Macedonia, and rushed as one man into the theater. Paul wanted to appear before the crowd, but the disciples would not let him. Even some of the officials of the province, Paul's friends of Paul, sent him a message begging him not to venture into the theater. So you see, friends, in this regard here for all of us, All right? That Christianity will always challenge us to a truth encounter. Christianity will always bring to the fore what is truth and what is not truth. And that's why we notice, friends, in Acts 19, in verse 26, let me read again what it says here like this. Okay, here's Demetrius saying, "And you see and hear how this fellow Paul has convinced and led astray large numbers of people here in Ephesus and in practically the whole province of Asia. He says that man-made gods are no gods at all. Man-made gods are no gods at all, which is the truth of the matter. But it's sometimes we're unwilling to let go. We still want to hold on to certain gods and certain things, thinking that they are gods, but they are not, isn't it? And that's the reason why, friends, can I say, truth that we see, all right, is not in something. Truth is not even in a set of beliefs or doctrines. Friends, truth is in a person, the person of Jesus Christ. And you and I must know that. And that's why we find Jesus says like this in John 14, verse 6. Let's read together. Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." No one comes to the Father except through me. And so, friends, you know, that's the reality of it all for every one of us. That Christianity will continue to challenge us about what is truth and what is truthful and what is appropriate and what is proper from lies, right? From deception, from idolatry, whatever man in form for all of us like this, isn't it? And that's the reason why, friends, because Christianity is the truth, we should be unafraid to share, to talk, to make known this truth that is in Christ to as many people as possible. And that's so critically important, isn't it? Just day before yesterday, met up with this wonderful man who came from a difficult background, meaning here in this case, to come to faith in Christ, there are huge challenges that this person has to face. Many obstacles, not just now, but in the future even as well. And so, sat down with him, spent time to talk, to interact with him, because I prayed for him before. He says, "Pastor, not yet. Challenging the faith in Christ, not yet." Smart guy, intelligent, intellectual. He wants answers. He wants to know the truth. He wants to know, is it real or not? So he took time to study, to explore, to find out. And rightly so, isn't it? We should, because God has given us a good mind. God has made us all rational beings, you see. And as rational beings that God has made and given to every human being on earth, whether we know him or not, whether we acknowledge him or not, it does not matter. This is a good God who has blessed us with a rationality of mind to be able to reason and persuade. Can good amen for that? That's the kind of God we have, a God who is good to every person on earth. But of course, a God who wants to draw people to himself, to faith in Christ, isn't it? All right, he is a perfect gentleman. He will never force his way in, but he will try to help you, if you're sincere about it, to reason you along. So I said to him, finally, tell me how you come to faith in Christ. After a long process, you know what he said to me? "Pastor, after I studied, I felt, looked to the Bible and everything, and especially look at the life of Jesus," he says this, "I was finally defeated by the love of Christ." Wow, this is the first time I ever heard, defeated by the love of Christ. Anyone who defeated by the love of Christ? Maybe no, defeated by your wife, wife's love, I mean. Defeated by the love of Christ. I said, "No, like, you are overwhelmed by the Christ's love, so overwhelms you." He says, "Let me explain." And he went on one by one. And now I can understand why. Isn't it? Why Christ's love begins to slowly compel him, reveal to him the truth of the matter about who this person, Jesus Christ, is. And finally, no other excuse and reason why he should not accept Jesus. And so he took that step of faith to trust Christ as Lord and Savior. Friends, you know, that's the kind of God we have. You know, I have talked with, witnessed to, and sometimes even argued and debated with some people who are atheists, who are non-Christians, and we went on almost locking horns like this. After a while, you know what I said to these people? I said, "You know what? I don't have to try to keep on like crazy proving to you that my Jesus is real and he's God and he's Lord. I don't have to. Because, you know, if I have to keep on supporting and propping up this God that I have to show to you He's really true, He's really alive, and He's really God. If I keep on propping Him up, what kind of God do I have? A God who is quite weak, isn't it? That needs my help to show that He is God. Of course, we should try our level best. By the way, if you want to have books to read, one of the best books around, okay, about Jesus is The Evidence of the Resurrection by Josh, okay? What is his name now?
McDowell,
that's right, Josh McDowell, okay? Volumes 1 and 2, thick, fat book that Josh McDowell collected tons of evidence to try to prove to you, all right, historically, theologically, all right, all kinds of things to show that Jesus is slow. Okay, read that book, thick book, volume 1, volume 2 has come up with. This, of course, come up for many years now. Read it and give your friends to read it for themselves, especially those who are intellectual, wanted a good, nice, okay, argument, debate. Whatever. Let them read and see what happens. But, you know, I say to these people, I say, friends, you know, if you don't have to keep on arguing and prop up this God that I have, He's more than able to take care of Himself. If I have to prop Him out, what kind of God I have? Must be quite weak, isn't it? I say, He can jolly well take care of Himself. So I say to these people, you know what? I say to them, you know what? Why don't you challenge Him? Why don't you challenge Him? You come before Jesus and say, Jesus, you know what? I don't believe in you. I don't. But if you're true, prove yourself to me. But I say there's one condition, only one condition. Provide it comes from a sincere heart. Hello? Provide it comes from a sincere heart. Because the Bible says, He who seek me shall find me when you seek me with all your heart. Amen, isn't it? God, He says to us, book of Jeremiah, if you seek me with all your heart, you shall find me. So therefore, you seek Him sincerely. He will definitely prove Himself because He's God, His Lord. He's unafraid about any human challenge. And many people over the years have challenged Jesus. But it comes from a sincere heart, I guarantee. He will show sooner or later. Can a good amen for that? And that's very, very important for all of us. Why? Because Christianity will always come through and break through, all right, to make a truth encounter and begin to know. Why? Because once you know the truth that is in Jesus, I'm the way, the truth, not just a truth, the truth and the life. No one comes to God the Father except in and by me. Friends, and when you know the truth, you know the life, you know the way. And therefore, you live a life of great freedom, peace, and joy, and with no fear whatsoever. And that's the reason why, friends, can I urge you again? We must be passionate, because if we've got the truth, we need to communicate the truth. We must go all out as much as possible to do so. We must seize every moment to do so. We cannot wait to, friends, you know, delay. And in fact, this was early morning in my journaling as I was spending time to reflect again, all over again, written before, and want to write again. The passion for the gospel and the urgency to share the gospel. It's so important for all of us. You know why? Church, can I say this? Satan is trying to stop every person from going to heaven. So he's trying to make us very reserved, very hesitant, very fearful in telling Jesus. Satan sometimes uses what? Human laws, get it passed to a country so that people cannot hear the good news of Christ and cannot get saved. That's the work of the devil. Friends, you and I must know. Satan is putting every obstacle, hindrance in the path of human beings on earth because he hates people going to heaven. But friends, you and I both got the key and the power. The key is the gospel of Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. And a good amen for that. So pray and powered by the Spirit, reach out to share. Ask God to deal with your fears, your hesitancy whatsoever, and reach out to share. And you never know. You will never know. Isn't it? Not only, friends, our fight is against the devil. That he's trying to put obstacles along the way, all right, through human laws, through our own reasoning, reservation, rationalization, our fears, our hesitancy. The other thing that the devil does is this, he blinds people. He blinds people. The God of this world has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the truth of God, the truth of Jesus, all right, the truth of God in the face of Jesus. He's caused a blindness to come over the light so that people cannot see. And how does Satan, all right, blind people's eyes? He blinds people through wealth. Because when we are wealthy, whatnot, I meet some of the wealthiest people around, both in Malaysia and Singapore, because of wealth, they see no need for the gospel. In fact, one of them who was present there, okay, at the meeting I'd spoken in Singapore just 3 days ago, he is the biggest builder in the whole of Singapore. And the CEO who's this richest man, called me up and said, Pastor Daniel, you know what? This biggest builder I invite to come, he invited a few other very top-notch people to come. And he says, you know, Pastor Daniel, this builder, I'm not a Christian, but he was very touched by what you said. Can you come back again? I said, sure, we're happy to do so. Because why? Because I'm burdened and concerned to get everybody in the kingdom of God. Can a good amen for that? That should be our burden, our passion, our heart, our desire. And it's so important, isn't it? So Satan does it, okay, by putting laws in a nation to prevent people from coming to Christ. Because Satan hates people from going to heaven. Satan, secondly, blinds people from doing that. But sometimes Satan, what he does it, he puts in a spiritual lethargy that we're lethargic about this good news and great news we have, that we have no, friends, urgency and impetus we want to share. Let me end off with this quote by C.T. Studd, Charles Thomas Studd, who played cricket for England when he was a student at Cambridge University. Brilliant guy, coming from a landed gentry background, coming from very wealthy parents, went to Eton College and then went to Cambridge University, Trinity College in Cambridge University. Outstanding. Future career charted out nicely for him and for his brothers, who all went to Cambridge. He was one of those so-called Cambridge Seven. There are six other guys from Cambridge University who are powerfully touched by the gospel, who have got a fantastic bright future ahead of them. Many of these come from very distinguished backgrounds themselves. Great future ahead. You know what? C.T. Studd, together with these six of them, now called Cambridge Seven, they went out as missionaries to China in 1885. It shook up the whole of Britain. Before they left for China, these seven were taken to city after city around UK to share their testimonies, their lives, and their challenge from God and their call from God to leave for China. People were stunned and shocked. These seven men with fantastic future ahead of them. There'll be bright lights just waiting for them along the way in UK. Where do you need to go? He left. They left. C.T. Studd, one of them. You know, friends, C.T. Studd inherited a huge fortune from his father, together with all his brothers. While he was a missionary, the father died. All the fortune he inherited, he gave it all away. More than that, I call him the first ever CIA agent for God. When I met with, you see, C.T. Studd went on to found what is known as WEC, W-E-C, Worldwide Evangelization Crusade, which is now today called just really WEC International, W-E-C International. Okay. I just recently met up with the international director in Singapore, and we're chatting and talking together. I was introduced to him for the first time. And when he told me I'm with WEC International, I'm the international director, I said, great, just wonderful. So we chatted, talk, catch up with one another, together, OM international director. And then I said, you know what, your founder, C.T. Studd, he was actually the first CIA agent for God. He got a bit worried. You know why? Because if you're called a CIA agent, it always means something negative. Hello, am I right? Are you still there with me? Or you're too sleepy now? No, isn't it? Yeah. He got a bit worried, honestly. I never knew my founder's a CIA agent. Wow, this is very serious. I said, yeah. I said, you know why? Because this great founder of yours, C.T. Studd, he served in China, in India, and in Africa as a missionary. Yeah. He said, wow, I never thought like that. Can I steal this phrase of your CIA agent and now use it for my whole organization? I'm not going to speak. Well, unless, okay, copyright reserve, unless you paid UMC, no, I didn't say that. He says, I never thought about it. I say, yeah, it's true. And friends, can I say this? C.T. Studd came up with some amazing quotes. Okay, and one of them is this. All right, one of them is this. C.T. Studd says, some people like to live within the sounds of church or chapel bells. I want to start a rescue shop, a yard from hell. Let me repeat. Some people like to live within the sounds of church or chapel bells. I want to start a rescue shop, a yard from hell. I'm committed to get people into the kingdom, committed to do everything possible because I'm involved in rescue mission. And friends, can I say, really, really, you and I are involved in rescue mission because people are headed towards hell. And without the gospel of Christ, people go into a crisis eternity. And that's the reason why, friends, you and I as God's people, there's my sense of urgency and passion and praying that God will intervene and help us to do so. Amen. Let us pray. With heads bowed and eyes closed. Maybe there are some of us here who have not trusted in Christ as Lord and Savior. I want to urge you, my friend. You're not here because of an invitation of a friend or relative, or maybe you just come in here on your own accord. If you're not trusted in Christ, you need to know there's a God who loves you, a God who has been waiting, a God who came, a God who died on the cross. The one without sin, and only the one without sin can take away our sin, your sin and mine, and that of the whole world. Jesus Christ, the Son of God, the sinless Son of God, He went, and to the terrible, painful, excruciating death, He took your place and my place. We should be there. But you know what, friends? God loves us so much. Jesus went. He has taken 99 steps to come to us, but He leaves us one final step. And one final step is the step of faith, that we will say yes. If we just need to say yes to Him, I acknowledge I'm a sinner. I believe, Jesus, You died on the cross for my sins. Please forgive me of my sins. Would You come into my life, be my Lord and my Savior? You pray that prayer, very simple prayer. But friends, can I say, remarkable things happen. Why? Because in that prayer, a prayer of faith and trust and sincerity, you are catapulted into God's kingdom. You are destined for heaven. Your name is written in the book of life, and you're in for a wonderful adventure of your life. And so, my friend, you have not taken the step of faith. Can I challenge you, urge you to do so? And so, with heads bowed and eyes closed, at a count of three, wherever you're seated, you've not taken the step of faith, but this noontime, you want to say yes to Jesus. Would you raise up your hand high so I can see your hand? I want to pray for you. Are you ready? One, two, and three. Is anyone here? Firstly, downstairs. Anyone? Thank you. Thank you. Yes. Yes, thank you. Two hands. Anybody else? Yes, thank you. Another one. Anybody else? It's a precious moment, my friend. God is here. Jesus has come. He loves us so much. Thank you. Yes, another hand. Anybody else? Yes, thank you. Over that side. Thank you. Okay. Anybody else downstairs? Thank you. Anybody else? What about up in the gallery, upstairs? Is anyone here? Could you raise your hand? You want to say yes to Jesus? Raise your hand high so I can see your hand. I want to pray for you. Is there anyone here? Anyone upstairs in the gallery? Well, those who put up your hands, would you say after me this prayer? Say aloud after me, church. Would you join in to encourage these people who have put up their hands? Would you say after me aloud together? Lord Jesus Christ, I thank You for Your love for me. Lord Jesus, I want to say that I'm a sinner. I believe You died on the cross for my sins. Please forgive me of my sins. And right now, please come into my life. Be my Lord and Savior. Take control of my life. Fill me with Your Holy Spirit. And give me Your power and authority to live as a Christian from today onwards. Thank You, Lord Jesus. Father, seal in the hearts of those who pray this prayer sincerely. You know those who pray this prayer sincerely, oh God. Some of these put up their hands, others may not put up their hands, but Lord God, You know them all, those who pray this prayer sincerely, who have not, oh God, earlier on, oh God, invite You into their lives. Seal it, Father, I pray, by Your power to the Holy Spirit. And bring to pass this new life, oh God. And that, Father, I pray You take them on this amazing ride of life. Oh, they're in, oh God, for a wonderful adventure in You. So bless these precious ones, Father, I pray, oh God. In Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. Shall we stand to sing this closing song? Shall we stand? Those who put up their hands, will they come right to the front where I'm standing? Because, okay, some of us leaders of the church want to pray for you further, give us some literature and help you. So those who put up their hands, will you come? Okay, two hands over that side there. One hand over that side, another hand. Okay, could you come? Those of you right at the back as well, come. Ushers, will help them to come forward. Maybe you pray that prayer sincerely. Would you come as well? We're going to pray for you, right? Okay? It does not matter if you're going to put up your hands. You'll come, okay? Some of you need to rededicate your lives anew and afresh. Would you come as well and pray for you, friends? You know, this is a time to be serious with God. This is a time to live for God wonderfully. Some of us, friends, we got fears. different kinds of fears, whatever fears in you come, we pray for you. Some of us got bondages and baggage in our lives. Maybe, friends, there are things afflicting your family. Maybe, friends, there is no freedom, there is bondage in your family tree. There's some kind of addictions, some kind of problems, some kind of things that happens to your family tree again and again. Would you come? We're going to pray for God to serve, to break that kind of thing. All right. Maybe addiction to gambling, addiction, friends, to pornography, right? Addiction to whatever else it may be, to alcoholism, that kind of thing. You come, church. Whatever it may be, church, will you come? Just as many. This is a time to receive the grace of God. Time, friends, to just experience God in a fresh new way. Comes time, friends, to know God's power and grace. Friends, will you come? Some of us are fearful about the gospel. To share, not to share. Will you come and pray for empowerment, that God will just really fill you and you in a fresh and give you the freedom, liberty and joy to share about Jesus with people. Maybe some of you, you've been praying for someone. There's no breakthrough yet. Would you come as well? We're going to stand and pray with you together to believe God for a breakthrough. It could be a friend, a colleague, a family member, a neighbor, whoever. You come as well, friends. So as you sing this song, church, can you come? Just as many upstairs come, staircases both sides, downstairs, just come forward. We're going to pray for you. Thank you, Lord.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close.
Thank you, Lord. Just come, friends, and receive the grace of God. Also, some of us not in good health, you come as well. We're going to pray for you. Okay. Friends, whatever limitations, whatever, yes, of the body, do come. We pray for you as well. For breakthrough, for healing from God.
I've tasted and seen of the sweetness of love. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, your presence, Lord.
Thank you, Lord. Friends, just come and receive God's grace, God's goodness and mercy is for us. Just come with you.
Holy Thank Spirit, you, Lord. You are welcome. Come flood this place and
nothing can compare
in you. Nothing can compare.
But it's God that we have. Just praise God. Maybe some of us has a sense of despair and hopelessness. You come, we pray for you, friends. Yes. There's something that's holding you back. Maybe a sense of despair, a sense of friends' disappointment, a sense of hopelessness. You come, we pray for you, friends.
Of sweetness of love. When my heart becomes free and my shame is undone, your presence, Lord. Oh, Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and
our hand, I want to pray for all of us. Really, I want to pray for a sense of urgency and passion to make known this amazing news. We are in for a race. indeed to stop people from going to a crisis eternity. We're in a spiritual battle with Satan, trying to keep people from heaven. So raise our hands, let me pray. Father, oh God, we stand before you. We all are in need of grace. We are all in need, oh God, of your mercies. Thank you, Father, most of all, for drawing us to yourself, drawing us into this amazing relationship with you, that we walk in freedom, in peace, and in joy. We walk without fear whatsoever, that there is deep assurance and confidence, oh God, that our lives are all in your good hands, Lord. And Father, now that we have known you, Lord Jesus Christ, with this good, amazing news of yours, the gospel of Christ, Father, I pray you help every one of us, Lord. Help every one of us with the urgency and a passion to do so. Give us wisdom and creativity, Father, how to talk, how to share with people around us, oh God. Particularly, Father, oh God, with people that we meet from day to day, our colleagues, our neighbors, our relatives, and our good friends, oh God. Father, we do not want to allow any of our good friends and colleagues and relatives, oh God, and neighbors to be lost in any way whatsoever. We do not want any one of them, oh God, to go into a Christless eternity. So, Father, I pray you empower every one of us, Lord. Every fear, every hesitation, every reservation, I take authority, Father, bind to loosen this thing from every one of us, oh God. Break through powerfully, Father, I pray, oh God, so that you will enable us and empower us, oh God, I pray, to share freely, genuinely, honestly, oh God, I pray, Father, with people around us, oh God, to make known yourself, Lord Jesus, our best and the greatest friend, oh God, to people around us, and to see at work in their lives. So, Lord, I pray your blessing upon these, my brothers and sisters, Lord. Give every one of them the joy, the privilege of leading at least one to Christ, Father, I pray. Over the next 6 months, oh God, I ask our Father, bless every one of these, oh God. So there be a great celebration, not just on earth and in heaven, because we know your word says to us, when one sinner repents and turns to you, all the angels in heaven rejoice. We want to celebrate with all the angels, oh God, rejoicing and celebrating in heaven. So, Father, I pray, help us, oh God, everyone, to have the joy, the blessing, the freedom to lead people to Christ. Oh God, I pray, Father. So that truly, Lord Jesus, oh God, there'll be great celebration, not only in heaven, but also on earth right now as well. So that we can all walk in peace, in freedom, in joy, oh God, in trust, in assurance, and in confidence. So bless us all, Father, I pray in this, oh God, I ask our Father. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord may his face shine upon you, be gracious towards you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you his perfect peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.